Sipa rolls out to the right, pitches off to Taylor, and Taylor's to the 20, down to the 15, down to 10, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, touchdown, Billy Taylor! Touchdown, Billy Taylor! Billy Taylor scored a touchdown from 21 yards out! The crowd goes berserk!
It was November 22nd, 1969. That they came to Barry, Michigan, all dressed in maize and blue. The words were said, the prayers were read, and everybody cried. But when they closed the coffin, there was someone else inside. Oh, they came to Barry, Michigan, but Michigan wasn't dead. And when the game was over, it was someone else instead. 11 Michigan Wolverines put on the gloves of gray, and as the organ played the victors, they laid Woody Hayes away.
Under center is Wangler at the 45. He goes back. He's looking for a receiver. He throws downfield to fire.
Who's got it better than us?
Nobody!
Welcome to the Michigan Man Podcast on Wolverine Sports Radio, a member of the VSporto Network, and in partnership with SB Nation's Maize and Brew, for Wolverine fans from coast to coast. Go Blue, and welcome to our Michigan Game Day show for this week. Our guest in just a few minutes will be John Borton from the Wolverine Magazine with his thoughts on the season to date and what he expects from the team moving forward. Before John jumps on, let us start with my view from Section 17 and a few words from Coach Jim Harbaugh. Here we go again, almost 20-point favorites this week. I suppose on paper that is fair. Minnesota is a young, rebuilding team, and they have been inconsistent on both sides of the ball early in the season, which is why most college football experts are predicting a Michigan rout on Saturday night. As John and I discussed today, we're on board with those experts. We've been around long enough to see more than a few great Michigan teams go down in flames, though, against inferior opponents. And that happened in 1977 up in Minneapolis when we were ranked number one. Now, we don't expect that to happen this week, but Jim knows we get everyone's best shot, and the key on Saturday night will be getting up early in this game, taking the crowd out, and sucking the life out of the Gophers. If we do that, we should head home on Saturday night with a 6-0 record. At his Monday presser this week, Jim talked about Roman Wilson and his big day last Saturday.
Yeah, that was incredible. Really kind of spurred the idea. We put... If somebody makes a great play or player of the game kind of thing, we do a picture of them in our team room. Now we're going to do a 3-in-1 collage because that play just needs three different pictures to really show how good it was. And the one he made, the second one he made was really great too. Love the way he's playing. I mean, he's getting a lot of attention now, and he's still winning, finishing. Plays, blocking.
He also had praise for his running back room, and once again, his quarterback, J.J. McCarthy.
The backs played really well, ran really hard, all three, Blake, Dono, and Clell. And a completely unselfish group. At a position where it's hard to be unselfish, they continue to be. Same with the quarterback, had one of his best games. He's just so efficient in how he plays the game and what he does for our offense. He really makes it go. But also completely unselfish, just like everybody on our team.
Jim was asked for his thoughts on what he's seen on tape from Minnesota.
Another really good defense, really stout. The quarterback's really coming along. They have a tremendous ability to run the ball. Physical team that is going to be, I love how they play. I mean, it's an emotional, fired up type of team. PJ does a great job. I mean, you can always tell they're confident. I mean, no matter what the stakes are, the odds are, you just see it in the way they play. They play hard. And it's all you can ever ask for as a coach from your players is that they play hard. Our guys are doing it. Minnesota's guys are. I mean, it'll be a football fight like it is every Saturday. And we got to play good. Get prepared, practice, and get ready to go execute in another one of those crazy college campus stadiums. Can't wait.
Saturday will mark the midway point of the season. My guest today says now is the time we expect to see Michigan making strides for the better on offense and find out if our defense can continue its dominant play. Joining us next is John Borton from the Wolverine Magazine. So don't go away. Today on our Michigan Game Day segment, as we prepare for a trip to Golden Gopher Land, is Senior Editor John Borton from the Wolverine Magazine. Once again, great to have you back, John.
Great to be with you, sir. And as always, fun to be talking Michigan football and various aspects of it.
Always. And before we talk about that Saturday night trip to Minneapolis, I thought, John, get some of your observations about this Michigan team through five games, see what you think. And let's start with last Saturday's Nebraska game, which, without a doubt, was the most complete performance of the season, wasn't it?
Absolutely. Statement game in every aspect. You come out and within, 8 minutes, you're up 14-0. You've had an incredible circus catch. You've had a 329-pound defensive lineman come up with an interception. You took a stadium full of Nebraska fans and absolutely stunned and silenced them. Bear in mind, this is a Nebraska team that was leading the nation in defense against the run, and you ran all over them. There was a Nebraska team that was running the football excellently themselves, and they couldn't gain enough ground to bury themselves in. It just was one of those deals where everything Michigan seemed to do was right. And if you listen to Matt Rhule, the Nebraska coach, I mean, you know, what do you say after a game like that? It was like, coach, what do you need to do to be like Michigan now? And he said, they're the number two team in the country right now. We're not in that conversation. And it was very clear that they weren't in that conversation, that Michigan very much is from start to finish in Lincoln.
I think the message was sent by halftime. I don't think I've ever watched a game in Lincoln where I looked at the beginning of the second half and said, where is everyone?
Oh, yeah. I mean, and that's an excellent opportunity when you get a situation where you're emptying the fans and they're surrendering. And you're able to, more importantly, focus on your own business. You saw waves of other players coming out there. You're seeing another three or four quarterbacks come out and get an opportunity to lead drives. Jay Denegal did an excellent job coming in. And these offensive linemen, you're building them deeper. You're getting all kinds of players that work so hard in practice. Even the ones that may not play a major role down the road in this particular season, they're getting on the field. They work. My good friend Jerry Hanlon always stressed this. They work just as hard in practice as other guys, and it is so good to get them on the field for team morale. There's nothing about that second half that was a waste. I mean, you look at it and you think, well, okay, I mean, it's game over. What good is it? But I think it can be a lot of good, and I think they used it well.
Well, John, some of the mailbag questions I get, and there are a lot of them these days, one of the biggest questions is about Donovan Edwards, it seems, each week. Some fans wondering, hey, is he healthy, or why has he not been more explosive? And, you know, we know he's a competitor. He'd like more carries, better numbers, but seriously, I mean, I think that's coming for him, don't you?
Oh, I think so. I mean, how much did he do that was super eye-catching before Ohio State last year? I mean, he had good games and all, but that it's like everybody has that performance in Columbus emblazoned on their psyche and on their mind when they think about Donovan Edwards, and it's easy to do. I mean, that's, you're talking about raising the bar super high. We talked to Donovan Edwards just last night down at Schembechler Hall, and you know, he said, I hear the critics, but I don't really pay close attention to them because, you know, they're not out there playing. He doesn't seem to think that there's anything wrong with him physically. I think he acknowledges that maybe he's missed some cuts at times that would have opened some things up. And maybe the holes, like they were at Ohio State, to get him in the open field might not have been there as much in the early season. He's not dwelling on that, but it's important to point out that this is an offensive line that has still been coming together. You had guys shipped in from Arizona, from California, you know, and it takes a bit to gel and to move forward as a unit so that you're all hitting on the same page. And I think that that's part of it. But, you know, I'll tell you, Donovan Edwards is a pretty good guy to have on your side, because when that open field comes around, or you get him free in a catching situation, which I think we haven't seen as much as we will, he can be awfully good. The other factor there is a Michigan team that, even by its own admission, hasn't opened up the playbook to the extent that it will. And there are many bigger games to come than what we've seen so far. So I think it would be unwise to write Donovan Edwards off just yet.
Jim's been very clear about the fact he wants some tread left on the tires for those running backs, which is really smart, especially for a guy like Blake Corum. Watching him now with his cuts and each week, it just looks like he is rounding into his old self, doesn't it?
Yes, and he, you know, by his own admission, as much as you initially talk, I'm going to be coming back stronger than ever, I'm going to do this and that, when it comes time to actually take contact, when it's time to make those first cuts on the practice field, you have to think about it, because he went down with a significant injury. And you're thinking about your present. What am I going to be able to do for Michigan now? You're thinking about your future. I mean, certainly this is the kid that wants to play in the NFL. You wonder, okay, it didn't hold up before. This is really the first time that something has happened to me like this. My body in some fashion has betrayed me. How much am I going to be able to go? And is it going to hold? And as you take those hits and as you make those cuts, then that old feeling starts to come back. And I think that Blake Corum has experienced that through the first five games of this season. He's looking confident. He's looking, you know, a little bit frustrated or angry with himself when he doesn't quite shake off that last tackle. I think that he's coming back very strong for this team.
Another aspect of the running game, though, that I like, and, you know, let me preface this by saying I think we're going to use three backs more often the rest of the way, based on what Jim is saying, too. So that's watching Khalil Mullings. I mean, I actually get excited watching him run. I mean, you cannot put a premium on how important it is to have a power back like him in that mix, can you, John?
There's no doubt about it. They always want somebody that can hit it hard and get that tough two or three or one in some cases yards. And Khalil Mullings has the size and the force to be able to do that. Not that Donovan Edwards or Blake Corum can't at times, but he is a bigger body, Mullings, and he's usually pretty fresh and rested, and that's an important part of this. But in Nebraska, he showed he's got a little burst too. I mean, he breaks free and gets a 20-yard touchdown. And think of it this way: Khalil Mullings knows at this point, with Corum and Edwards as the 1-2 punch, that he is going to have limited opportunities. So his mindset is, man, I'm going to get in there, and when I am in there, I am going to give every single ounce, every fiber of my being is going to go into playing super hard and giving it my all on this play. So that's the kind of effort you're getting that maybe for somebody that's played 40, 45 snaps in a game the sheer fatigue factor, you wouldn't get as much. So Mullins is becoming a very important part of this deal.
Well, another thing I wanted to talk about is J.J. McCarthy. I was listening to PJ Fleck's presser on Monday, and he just went on and on about J.J., which so much of the national media does. And I know fans want to see J.J. slinging it around the yard more, but, you know, to me, John, what's more impressive about his play is how he wants to get everyone involved and give credit to everyone else. It's not about the numbers for J.J. It's about the team. It's about getting wins. I'm not sure everyone appreciates what it's like to have a selfless leader like he is, John, but it does say so much about his character, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And I guarantee you that it would be very important to PJ Fleck, because I listened to the same press conference and wrote about it in the column that's going to be on our website today. And just the admiration of PJ Fleck for what Jim Harbaugh has done and what he has put in place. PJ Fleck said, look, if your hardest workers are your best players, like J.J. McCarthy, and if you have a J.J. McCarthy that goes into the press conference and says the things that he says, he's asked the question about himself, and he starts talking about other people, how they make his job easier, how they help him. He said, Jim Harbaugh is all about the team, the team, the team. And when your quarterback gets in a press conference and sounds like the head coach, and it's authentic and it's real, absolutely, that is what you want. That's when you know you have something. And these other coaches can see it too. Jim Harbaugh said before the season, J.J. McCarthy is like Patrick Mahomes and Josh Allen of the NFL. And immediately people cut it off there and cut the quote off there and said, whoa, what's he saying? Where is he going? But the rest of the quote, and it was a question that I asked of Jim, was the fact that he was like them in his unselfish leadership, and that his ability to want to make people better. And he's not here complaining that, wait a minute, I only threw for 150 some yards. And how is this going to help my Heisman chances and this and that? J.J. McCarthy doesn't care. He's 5-0. He's got the best completion percentage in the country right now. He's got a team around him that is building and very successful. He wants to win the national championship. He wants to win the Big Ten championship again. He wants to go into Ohio State in the last game of this regular season and deliver a message. And he did in Columbus, certainly last year. He knows he has a team around him that is capable of doing it again. And that's all he cares about. And so there's no doubt there are a lot of coaches that are very envious of Jim Harbaugh for having a quarterback like J.J. McCarthy. And Jim Harbaugh is glad he does, but certainly has input into how McCarthy is developed.
Well, another kid I can't say enough about is Roman Wilson. I mean, that TD catch last week where he pinned the ball on the Nebraska defender's helmet was so freaky good. And he deserves some love, I think, finally, because, you know, when we look back at the last 2 years, he really hasn't been completely healthy, which we know, but he's still been productive. Michigan fans haven't seen him as a number one kind of receiver. I think they do now. I mean, I see people in some of the blogs or message boards calling him the flying Hawaiian now, but whatever you call him, he has arrived, hasn't he, John?
Oh, there's no doubt about it. Leading the country in touchdown catches. That's and in an offense that is admittedly spread out and unselfish and not focused on any one player. And here's a guy that's been the most productive touchdown pass catcher in the country and now has one that ranks right up there with Desmond against Notre Dame in 1991 or Braylon Edwards soaring over the Spartans in the Comet game in 2004 or Marquise Walker, at Iowa with the one-handed catch. Your more seasoned listeners will recall all of those. And it's that catch was something else. And we talked to Roman, and he said, I don't know why people are getting that crazy about it. Maybe because I took the kid's head with me because the ball was pinned against it.
Yeah.
But that's just an amazing catch. You watch that over and over again. The concentration and the strength. And now Roman Wilson gives a shout out to Ben Herbert on that one, Michigan's strength and conditioning coach, not only for he calls it grip strength, to be able to hold the ball in that situation, but also the mindset of, is it not the perfect pass? No, it's into the back of the head of the defender. So what? Let's make it, that gives you an opportunity to make a great play. And see, that's another example of a Michigan player deflecting the credit. He gives a, hey, shout out to Ben Herbert for all that he teaches. But absolutely, Roman Wilson is now on everybody's mind and on everybody's list because of the amazing catch at Nebraska and the fact that it draws attention to, hey, this kid is pretty all-around good. Look at the numbers.
That first catch was amazing, but his second touchdown in the end zone when JJ was rolling out to the left and threw a laser to the back of the end zone, his footwork and his concentration to stay in bounds was also incredibly impressive.
Absolutely. Roman Wilson said that they put an emphasis last year on starting to ramp up scramble drills, because you know with J.J. McCarthy, there are going to be those situations. I mean, and on that particular play that you reference, J.J. starts to his right and then completely spins around. He's running against his body. Very tough throw, but it's not a catch unless you've got a receiver that is scrambling and seeing and understanding what's happening. And Roman Wilson had the presence of mind to be running along the kind of exactly like J.J. McCarthy back 20-25 yards downfield, and staying inbounds and making himself available and getting open and having the concentration to make that catch. So absolutely, that is a very different catch in a very different way, but it shows off another aspect of both quarterback and receiver that is really clicking right now.
John, one of the other things I get a lot of in my mailbag is I think it goes back to Big Ten media days when Jim said our goal is to be a 50-50 team, which, you know, a lot of the fans, that's what they're waiting for. But I think it's funny sometimes because the modern part of me says, yeah, we want to do that. But the 1960s and 70s guy in me says, you know, if you control the line of scrimmage and you impose your will in any era of college football, you win. And after Saturday's Nebraska game, I was thinking, you know, with Jim up back on the sidelines, is this Nebraska game maybe a preview of what he really wants to do again? I know Sharon would probably like to sling it around more, but the mentality that Jim has instilled in this program and this team, when they do what they did to Nebraska and come out and just ram the ball down the throats of the number two rushing defense in the country, that's a beautiful thing to watch, isn't it?
Oh, there's no question about it. And there's a part of Jim Harbaugh that has paying tribute to Bo Schembechler yeah. ingrained in him. And, you know, I was around for those 70s as well. Those were great games, great moments, great overpowering Michigan teams that just throttled people with their offensive lines and their defense and all those sorts of things. But I think Jim Harbaugh is also practical enough to understand that, you know what, that's can be our bread and butter at times. But having been to the NFL, having been to big games in college, he understands that in that Ohio State game, I believe it was 10 yards that Michigan ran for in the first half. They were running their heads against a brick wall. If they don't have that other aspect of the team, if you're not finding Cornelius Johnson behind the Ohio State defense, maybe things don't loosen up as much. So they use that, and they have that in their arsenal that then opens that second half up for the runs that everybody remembers for Donovan Edwards. And you have to be able to go toe-to-toe with a TCU and throw effectively. Michigan got into trouble when you had a couple of the pick sixes, but they got back into the game because J.J. McCarthy was able to go and throw and throw and throw. So I think yeah, there's a part of me that says control it and exert your dominance. And there's certainly a part of Jim Harbaugh that coaches that way. But there's also that aspect of, you know, be well-rounded, because this is a Michigan team that will be in those games again at Penn State, at or Ohio State, at Michigan. And then, you know, quite possibly the Big Ten championship game and quite possibly the playoffs. And if you find yourself there, you better be able to do both.
Yeah, and I think that's what we're seeing this offense evolve into, one that can do what it needs to do to win and to move the chains. But the flip side of that is, if you watch the defense and how dominant they are, and we hope they continue to be, the secondary is not even completely healthy yet. So I ask myself, you know, why get crazy on the offensive side? You play to your strength, especially when you get into midseason and see what you have on the defensive side, because until I see differently, this defense is what could be driving us this year, and we just don't have to go air raid when you've got these guys in the field, do we?
You're absolutely right, and we'll go right to Harbaugh's description of it as the we fence, that those things, the offense, the defense, they need to work in concert. The best defense we've often heard is the defense that's standing on the sideline watching the offense grind people. And that's what you've got the capability of in this Michigan team. Another PJ Fleck reference when he said Michigan has the opportunity and the ability to control the ball and really shorten the game, shorten the possessions that the other team's going to get with it. And by doing so, it helps the defense immensely. This is a defense that is averaging 5.75 points a game given up, just a ridiculous stat at this point. People are going to automatically say, well, yeah, but they haven't played, you know, the toughest teams. And that is true. You may not get some real credit for this defense until the 12th game of the season. I mean, if you win at Penn State and you have a good defensive effort, it'll come then. But it'll really come after you get through this regular season and you've done what you want to do. But from every indication, and you make a great point, that this is a lineup that has just gone without some of its best players for long stretches.
Mm-hmm.
And they are slowly working their way back. We haven't seen this defense personnel-wise what it can be. And that's still something certainly to look forward to.
Yeah, and that should scare opponents, because it has not been a healthy unit yet. And just look what it's accomplished so far. So unbelievable. Now this Saturday night, of course, under the lights against Minnesota, a big coast-to-coast game. I mean, the Gophers are going to be jacked up. I like PJ Fleck. He's a guy that he does it right. He loves his players. He knows how to motivate. But, you know, when you look at both sides of the ball and what we've seen from Minnesota so far this year, it's a young, rebuilding team. If Michigan comes in, you play clean, you play with passion, play through that early crowd craziness in Minneapolis, this year just looks like a W, doesn't it?
Oh, and there's no question about it. You look at Minnesota, they have already lost to Northwestern in overtime. They took on the exact same Nebraska team that Michigan destroyed on Saturday, and they had to survive 13-10, and that was in Minnesota. I mean, this is a game on paper that Michigan should take control of, just like it took control out in Lincoln. That said, you know, you don't have to go any farther than Jim Harbaugh and his playing career to understand that a heavily underdog Minnesota team can come up and bite you. I don't think it's going to happen in this situation, but you can't, if you're Michigan, you cannot give them room to breathe. You can't make that early turnover. You can't do something that gives the home crowd life and just gives them hope that, hey, we can stay in this game. And so that's, I think that we saw on Saturday how good this Michigan team can be in, okay, we're on the road. We embrace this. We're going to have fun. Whatever tradition they have, we're going to, you know, we're going to jump around in Wisconsin, or we're going to dance to Thunderstruck in Nebraska. We're going to make that fan favorite activity our own, and we're going to own your team. So I think that's why the first few minutes of this game will tell you a lot about whether it's one of those road Big Ten kind of edgier cedars. Oh man, they got to hang on. I can't believe that this is happening. Or it's going to be Nebraska part two.
And John, I'm a nervous Nelly every week. It doesn't matter who we're playing, but you know, teams like the Gophers always make me cautious, and maybe it's because I've been around for a while, and I'm getting old, but you know,
you remember Ricky Foggy.
Oh man, I remember Ricky Foggy, and you know what? The game that still sticks out to me the most is that 77 game when we were ranked number one. Yeah, went up to Minneapolis, lost 16-0. Now that was a decent Minnesota team. They had beaten UCLA, I think, out in LA earlier in the season, so they were 4-2. But they went into that game. Their backup quarterback was the starter, and I still remember Ufer's agonizing play-by-play as that game closed. 16-0, Minnesota won that ball game. That still bothers me to think about. You know, but that lesson from 77, it's still good today. You better bring your A game, because the Gophers, they were capable then, and they can win on Saturday if we don't bring it. So you've really got to shut out the outside noise, and oh, it's a 20-point game, it's going to be another blowout. You got to be ready.
No doubt about that, and I'll check on your 1977 and raise you a 1976 Michigan at Purdue Ross Ade Stadium. Oh, yeah. And the Wolverines, you know, lose 16-14. It's we can all recall those moments that it just, for whatever reason, whether a team got a little bit too comfortable, and I don't see any signs of that in this team.
No.
But That's the thing. You it's football, and it happens. If you look around the country right now, you look at the survivals that Georgia has endured so far. You look at Alabama going down. You understand. Don't let it happen to you.
Well, John, final question before we let you get away. I mean, this is one of those jumping ahead questions, which is just for fun. But from what you've seen of Penn State and Ohio State so far, does it make you feel better about Michigan's chances against them, or is it even too early to ask a question like that?
Well, it's not too early, because we certainly watch, and you're never going to get anything like this out of Jim Harbaugh or the Wolverines. They dodge those questions. I mean, like Barry Sanders used to dodge tackling. but as you look, at Penn State, they are very solid. There's no question about that. But, I mean, Northwestern was playing them straight up at halftime. And this is not an invincible Penn State team. It's gotten a lot of hype, but I think – and it will be very, very tough at home. Always is, regardless. But the folks that are picking – or preseason picked Penn State in that game, I think you're more likely to see a Judgment Day light from 1997 out in Penn State than you are to see Penn State doing a number on the Wolverines. As far as Ohio State's concerned, still uber talented, still has a lot to offer, but this will be the first time in a while that Michigan has faced a first-year quarterback, starting quarterback for them. I will say this, that by the end of the season, there are no complete rookies in this game, because you've played an entire regular season.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you look at that slugfest at Notre Dame, and you know, all credit to Ohio State for hanging in there and pulling it out on the very last play. That wasn't it's a sign of how good you are if you can win at Notre Dame with a decent Notre Dame team, but B, this is not an Ohio State offense that is going to generate the kind of just off the chart points in tougher games than it has in the recent past. So I think that Michigan is in very good stead with both of those teams. I don't think that you're going to have to go into them wondering what's going to happen. Michigan players remember going into Penn State and winning a close one the last time. It absolutely remembers what it did down in Columbus last year. And that means a lot. That's, you think of how many years Michigan, Ohio State in recent days has been a, oh no, what's going to happen now?
Yeah.
From a fan perspective, and some of that has to creep in, although it'll never be spoken by a player. They weren't used to beating Ohio State. All of a sudden they are again. So I think that they're in good shape in both those areas. Now they just have to continue to polish things and get your defensive people back and keep moving forward week by week.
That is right. And take care of business Saturday night in Minneapolis against the Gophers, which I think we will. So here with us today has been senior editor John Borton from the Wolverine Magazine. Always good stuff, John. Love having you on the show, and we look forward to our next visit.
All right. I appreciate it, Mike. It's great to be with you. And as always, it's fun to talk about a program that's doing so well.
On Quick Hits today, Jim didn't have specific injury news on Monday. He just said there are always guys working through things during the season, and we have several of those. Overall, team health is good, and we'll see how much playing time some of our banged-up secondary guys get this week. Mason Graham is expected to miss at least one more game with his thumb injury. Here are some game day notes of interest for this Saturday's battle for the Little Brown Jug. We lead the series with 76 wins against 25 losses, and there have been three ties. The first meeting was in Minneapolis on October 17th of 1892, a 14-6 win for the Gophers. The last time these two teams met was in the 2020 COVID season, with no fans in attendance. We won 49-24. That was on October 24th of 2020. Head coach PJ Fleck is in his seventh year as head man there. His record is 47-29. Overall, in 11 years as a head coach, he is 77-51. Last year, Minnesota ended the season with a 9-4 record, 5-4 in the Big Ten, good for second in the West. They played in the Pinstripe Bowl and defeated Syracuse 28-20. The weatherman is calling for dry weather on Saturday night. Temps at game time will be near 50, slipping into the 40s during the game, so another great night for football. So it's time for another primetime night game for us. The crowd will be amped up as you'd expect, and PJ Fleck will have his guys ready to go. You can count on it. They do have some players, and they know the key is to hang in there early, keep it close, and who knows what can happen if they are still in it in the second half. For our part, we need to get out on top early and suck the life right out of them. It's what we've done to everyone else so far this season, and on the road, that is even more important. That does it for another week. Enjoy Saturday night's primetime battle for the Little Brown Jug, and have a great Wolverine weekend, everyone. I'm your host, Mike Fitzpatrick. Think victory, beat Minnesota. Until we meet again, take care. And as always, go blue. Thanks for joining us today on The Michigan Man, here on Wolverine Sports Radio, a member of the VSporto Network, and in partnership with SB Nation's Maize and Brew. Our listener lines are open 24/7 for your calls at 313-263-4842. That's 313-263-4842. or email us at themichiganmanpodcast@yahoo.com. That's themichiganmanpodcast@yahoo.com. The Michigan Man Podcast is produced at the studios of Robin Lynn Productions, Allen Park, Michigan, and is not affiliated with the University of Michigan. Go Blue!